Hi everyone, welcome back to my channel. Today I'm gonna be starting my review of radiologic positioning, image analysis, and pathology. To be a good radiographer, it is very important to learn the human anatomy. Understanding what the images are showing and what they mean require a very solid foundation in anatomy and physiology. Radiographers must possess a thorough knowledge of anatomy, physiology, osteology to obtain radiographs that show the desired body part. Anatomy is the term applied to the science of the structure of the body. The radiographer must be able to visualize mentally the internal structures that are to be radiographed. Please read your radiographic positioning book to better understand and relate to these topics. The first step in any radiographic examination is to properly identify the patient. Second, a brief explanation of the radiographic procedure should be provided, followed by a thorough patient history pertinent to the body part being examined. Next, the patient is provided instructions on what articles of clothing and jewelry must be removed to help prevent artifacts on the images. PA and lateral images are obtained when possible. Chest images are taken on second inspiration to expand the lungs and visualize lung markings. The radiographic appearance of lung markings are used to verify pathological condition. Chest images should include from the apices to the costophrenic angles. Central ray at T7, SID 180 cm to reduce magnification of the heart shadow. If possible, perform chest images in the erect position to move the diaphragm to its lowest position. Markers indicating the correct side of the patient and patient position should be indicated. Remove radiopaque articles like snaps, bra, and external lines if possible. Positioning the cathode side of the X-ray tube over the thicker part of the anatomy provides more uniform radiation exposure of the image receptor. In chest radiography, the cathode should be inferior. The lower thorax in the region of the diaphragm is considerably thicker than the upper thorax and therefore requires higher radiation intensity if X-ray exposure of the image receptor is to be uniform. Instruct the patient to stand facing the vertical grid device. Be sure to tell the patient to distribute his or her weight equally on both feet. Adjust the height of the vertical grid to 2 inches or 5 centimeters above the relaxed shoulders. Center the patient's mid-sagittal plane to the middle of the vertical grid. Place a side marker on the correct side of the patient. Assist the patients in placing the backs of the hand low on the hips. This will ensure that the arms are abducted out of the collimated field and that the hands are low enough not to be demonstrated on the image. Align the collimated field to enter the patient at the mid-sagittal plane at the level of T7. Gently roll the patient's shoulders forward so that their anterior surfaces touch the vertical grid device. This motion rotates the scapulae laterally and out of the lateral lung fields. Instruct the patient to raise the chin enough to rest it on the vertical grid device. Check to be sure that the patient is looking straight ahead to avoid rotation of the shoulders. Align the collimated field to enter the patient at mid-sagittal plane at the level of T7. T7 is located by palpating the inferior angle of the scapula. Finally, instruct the patient to take a deep breath, exhale, take in another deep breath, and hold it. These breathing instructions help achieve greater aeration of the lungs with less effort. Adequate aeration of the lungs is evidenced by 10 posterior ribs seen above the diaphragm. Our finished radiograph should demonstrate air-filled trachea, lungs, diaphragmatic domes, aortic valve, apices to costoprenic angles, scapulas outside of the lung field, 2.5 cm of apex of the lung seen above the clavicles. 3 ribs should be seen above the clavicles. Instruct the patient to turn and stand with the left side closest to the vertical grid device. Be sure to remind the patient to distribute his or her weight equally on both feet. The left lateral position places the heart closer to the image receptor so that it is demonstrated with minimal magnification. As you provide verbal instructions, demonstrate how to raise the arms over the head. Flex the elbows and rest the forearms over the head. Be sure to bring the patient's elbows inwards to minimize the distance between the patient's thorax and the vertical grid. Instruct the patient to raise the chin and look forward straight ahead. This will help prevent rotation and keep the chin from being demonstrated in the image. To help ensure that the patient is in a true lateral position without rotation, check to be certain that the mid-coronal plane of the patient is perpendicular to the vertical grid. This plane should also be centered to the midline of the vertical grid device. The patient's shoulders and hips should be aligned, with no forward or backward bending that may distort the lungs. Align the collimated field to enter the patient at the mid-coronal plane and the level of T7, which may be located by palpating the inferior angle of the scapula. Instruct the patient to take in a deep breath, exhale, take in another deep breath, and hold it. These breathing instructions help achieve greater aeration of the lungs with less effort. Radiographic examination of the chest normally requires upright PA and lateral projections. In the upright position, the lungs can expand more fully with air, and if fluid is present, it will layer out in the inferior aspect of the lungs. However, there are situations in which the patient is too ill to stand upright, but the air fluid level must be demonstrated. The decubitus position may be used in place of the upright positions to provide quality diagnostic images of the chest. Decubitus positions all have two common elements, a horizontal central ray and a recumbent body position. In this photo, the patient is in the recumbent right lateral position. This decubitus position will demonstrate fluid in the right lung, because fluid will settle in the dependent lung. Any free air that might be present will rise and be demonstrated along the lateral wall of the left lung. At least 5 minutes is required for the fluid to accumulate in the dependent portion of the lung. For this reason, the patient should be placed in the appropriate decubitus position for a minimum of 5 minutes or longer before the exposure is made. This is a lateral decubitus chest image. The arrows denote the fluid level in the right lung. If fluid is a primary concern, the radiographer must be sure to elevate the dependent side to include the entire right lung. Notice the marker indicating that the left side is up. This is a common practice in marking the cubitus positions. In this radiographic image, the patient was in the left lateral decubitus position. The arrows denotes the free air in the right lung, which is termed a pneumothorax. It is also evident in this image that the fluid in the left lung was not of a primary concern. Because the left lung is not entirely demonstrated, this is because the patient's thorax was not elevated enough to demonstrate the entire dependent lung. It is essential to understand the reason for a chest exam before the proper decubitus chest position can be chosen. This photo demonstrates the dorsal decubitus position for the chest. This position yields a lateral projection with the right lung demonstrated because the patient's right side is closer to the image receptor. As with the lateral decubitus positions, fluid will collect in the dependent portion, which in this position is the posterior lungs. Free air will rise to the top or anterior surface. Ventral decubitus positions may be necessary in critically ill patients who cannot be turned on their sides. This is the radiographic image of the chest with the patient in the dorsal decubitus position. The fluid level in the dependent or posterior lungs is indicated by the arrows. Ideally, the patient's thorax would have been elevated on a radiolucent support to help prevent clipping of the most posterior portion. Decubitus chest positions are difficult because they are generally used in the most gravely ill patients. I hope that this presentation has made clear to you the importance and necessity of these positions. Thank you for watching. I hope you learned a lot from this vlog and stay tuned for more to come.